start with classifications, there are more than 20 classifications of traumatic injuries to the teeth. But the most commonly used ones are Ellis and Daveys classification, which was proposed in 1970, and the Anderson classification based on the WHO system, which is something which can be used for both the primary as well as the permanent teeth. So first we'll see the Ellis and Daveys classification. So Ellis and Daveys, it has total 9 classes. Class 1 to 8 is for permanent teeth, and class 9 is for primary teeth. So we'll see one by one what are these categories. So class 1 to 9, you can see on the screen, and we'll see photographs of each of these to better understand what is class 1 to class 9. So Ellis class 1 is a simple fracture of the tooth or the crown in which the enamel is only involved. You can see the blue arrow indicating that. Ellis class 2 is in which there is extensive fracture of the crown involving the enamel and the dentine, but the pulp is not exposed here. And how do we know enamel and dentine is involved? We have to examine it visually and confirm whether the enamel and dentine both are involved in this fracture. Ellis class 3, it is a fracture, extensive fracture of the crown in which the enamel dentine is involved and the pulp is also exposed. It can be a pinpoint exposure as you see here, or it can be a larger exposure as in the second case. So Ellis class 3 is a pulp exposure. Ellis class 4, it is the traumatized tooth becomes non-vital, which can be ascertained by discoloration of the tooth or confirmed with the help of electrical pulp vitality testing. So Ellis class 4 is a tooth becomes non-vital due to trauma. Class 5 is avulsion. The tooth has been completely come out of the socket. So this is the most severe form of traumatic injury that can happen to a tooth. Ellis class 6 is fracture of the root, which can be confirmed only on the radiograph with or without the loss of the crown structure. And class 7 is luxation injuries or displacement injuries in which the tooth has been displaced partially, either outside the out of the socket partially, or in the socket, or in a labial or palatal direction, or mesial or distal direction also. Ellis class 8, that is fractured crown in mouth, that is a complete crown structure is fractured in this particular case. Now Ellis class 9 is any type of fracture of the deciduous tooth, be it luxation injury like this, or a non-vital tooth because of trauma, or a root fracture. Any type of fracture of a deciduous tooth is categorized as Ellis class 9. This you have to keep in mind. That any type of fracture of deciduous tooth, be it enamel or dentine, or be it a pulp exposure, or be it luxation injury, or the tooth has become non-vital, it is always going to stay Ellis class 9. So this is Ellis and Daveys classification, total 9 classes, 1 to 8 for permanent teeth, and 9 is for entirely for deciduous teeth. Now coming to the second most commonly used classification, Andreasons classification based on the WHO system. This classification has 4 broad categories. That is, first is injuries to the heart, dental tissues and pulp. Second is injuries to the supporting tissues, that is the periodontal ligament. Then third is the injury to the supporting bone, that is the alveolar bone proper, alveolus and the maxilla and the mandible. Lastly, there is injuries to the gingiva or the oral mucosa, or the soft tissue injuries. So we'll see one by one each of these categories. Firstly, the injuries to the heart, dental tissues and the pulp. So injuries to heart, dental tissues, that is enamel, dentine and the pulp, we can try to remember it this way, that it has total 7 categories, in which the first 4 are the injuries to the crown. The last 3 would be the fractures involving the root. And you see there are codes given to it. These are the codes which have been taken from WHO's International Classification of Diseases as applied to dentistry and stomatology. So these codes are important because these codes represent a particular type of fracture. So we'll see one by one. That is, first is enamel infraction, in which there is an incomplete enamel crack. Then there is uncomplicated crown fracture, in which only the enamel is involved. So this is something very similar to Ellis class 1. Then you have uncomplicated crown fracture where you have enamel and dentine involved. So this is similar to Ellis class 2. Then the fracture severity increases and it is a complicated crown fracture where the fracture is such that it is exposing the pulp and it can be seen clinically. Coming to the last three parts, uncomplicated crown root fracture, where enamel, dentin, and the cementum is involved, but the pulp is not exposed yet. It becomes complicated when the enamel, dentin, and the cementum is involved, and the pulp is also is involved and clinically seen. Last is root fractures. So we will see these same in with the help of photographs. So this is uncomplicated crown fracture. You see first one, only the enamel is involved. Second one, you see that the dentin is involved here. Then when the pulp is clinically exposed, it becomes a complicated crown fracture. Then you have uncomplicated crown root fracture, where the fracture line is extending from enamel, dentin, ending on the cementum, but the pulp is nowhere involved in this. Becomes complicated when the fracture line is passing through the pulp. Then lastly, you have root fractures. Coming to the second category, that is injury to the periodontal tissues or the supporting tissues. You have six categories in this. First is concussion, then is subluxation. These are in which the tooth is not displaced. Then you have displacement injuries or luxation injuries, in which you have extrusion, you have lateral luxation, intrusive luxation, and exarticulation. So in concussion, the tooth is only tender because there is only edema in the periodontal ligament due to trauma. The second category is subluxation, where you have the tooth is tender as well as mobile. Why? Because there is edema as well as some tear of periodontal ligament. So the tooth has not been displaced from the socket. Then there is extrusive luxation. The name itself is telling you, and the diagram also shows you, that the tooth has come out partially from its socket. So there is tear of the periodontal ligament here. Lateral luxation means displacement of the tooth in any direction other than the axial. It could be labial, it could be palatal, or it could be mesial or distal direction. Then there is intrusive luxation. The name is telling you that the tooth has been displaced axially inside the socket. Lastly, the most severe form, that is exarticulation. That is, the tooth has completely come out of the socket. Coming to the third subcategory, injuries to the supporting bone, in which you have combination of the alveolar socket. Combination of alveolar socket means that alveolar socket has been completely crushed. So in this generally happens with intrusive injuries. Fracture of the alveolar socket wall, that is alveolar socket wall might be fractured, maybe facially, maybe palatally. Then there is fracture of the alveolar process. The alveolar process might be fractured. Then it could be a fracture of maxilla or the mandible, or you might have a combination in which the fracture line is such that it is involved in the alveolar socket also, alveolar process, and also the maxilla and mandible is fractured. Coming to the last subcategory, that is injuries to the gingiva or the mucosa, in which you have laceration. Laceration is something which is a sharp cut on the soft tissue. It is something which is akin to an incision which we give with the help of a scalpel and blade. Then there is contusion. Contusion is a kind of injury which happens with a blunt object. It is something which is causes hematoma formation and bruising of the oral mucosa. It is similar to something when your hand gets caught in a door, you see hematoma formation in your nail. That is something similar to contusion. So last is abrasion, in which there is loss of the epithelium, that is peeling of the epithelium. When this happens, when the impacting object rubs against the soft tissue, that is when you have an abrasion injury. So that is the Andreasons classification based on the WHO system with all the different codes given to it. Now coming to other classifications, at least you should know some other classification names. Hargreaves and Craig classification. You have a classification given by Garcia and Godoy. You have classification given by Pulvers and Ulfon also. So there are many other classifications, but at least you know certain names, the two main commonly used classifications, and the names of certain other classification is good.